Don Schlitz wrote a song back in the 80s, I believe it was, called The Gambler, which Kenny Rogers made a big hit, okay? I thought it was real interesting. I was reading the article, and I've got a copy of it here, where Don was talking about something called writer's block. I'm like stuck in the brain. I can't get anywhere. No inspiration. I don't know where to go with this or that. And so Don said, and those of you who play guitar will know what I'm talking about with this, but he said, I have a friend named Bob McDill who's written some incredibly great songs in the country genre. Bob has been a supporter of mine ever since I got to Nashville. This was written back in the 80s. He said, one August afternoon, I had a long conversation with McDill about writer's block. I had been blocked for about 6 months, pretty much since my father died. I was so caught up in my own feelings, I guess, that nothing was really translating on the paper. That day, Bob showed me the open D tuning on the guitar. Does that mean anything to you? Open D tuning on the guitar? Okay. He told me that this tuning had helped him simplify songwriting by making everything so precise and so compact that it wouldn't let him do anything real fancy and get screwed up. I made the long walk home. I didn't have a car then. Sat down at the typewriter, tuned my guitar to the detuning, and in 2 hours I wrote three songs. One of them was The Gambler. Three songs. One of them was The Gambler, which I wrote in about 20 minutes. That is everything but the last verse. Then he goes on to tell you it took him months to write the last verse because he said, then he goes on telling a story about how it became a big hit and everything, and he said, and I'm still a little amazed that I wrote the song. First of all, I've never been on a train in my life. And I'm a terrible poker player. There are just a lot of things in that song that I do not know about. Okay? So he had not experienced this stuff. He just wrote about the gambler. Then he goes on telling you about it. He translated the meaning of the song later to be about his father. It's really about the stories he learned from his father, the lessons he learned in life from his father. So, talking about writer's block, he's just talking about changing just the way you tune the guitar. Dropping it into a different step or picking up a different instrument. And we joke about buying a new guitar. That's a good reason, because a new guitar usually has some different songs for you in it. I had a buddy recently that loves me so much, I joke with him about this. He gave me a little baby Taylor guitar. And this guy owns about 15 guitars, but he just doesn't play acoustic guitar a lot. And he wanted a new electric, and he said, you know what, Tony, you helped me out on a couple of things. I'm just giving, you know what the guitar has done for me now? It's given me five new songs. Little bitty baby Taylor guitar, tune it just like a regular, but it's a different sound, a different tonality. It feels different when you play it. And I asked a keyboard player in my group, I said, well, tell me about that. If you play piano, what do you do? He said, I just go to a different patch. I get a different sound on the piano, and it inspires me, it turns, you know, the wheels of my brain a little different. So if you're writing, have you ever found that to be true? About just being a different place, maybe? Maybe instead of writing in wherever the room or place that you normally write and create, you go somewhere different. I finished a Gil Fox project. One of those songs was in the park in downtown Raleigh, which I'd never written in before. I just went out there with a guitar one day and sat down and wrote. And that's how I finished. I had writer's block and couldn't finish it. Nashville, about you guys write everything by committee. Unless you get a room this size and, you know, like a, I guess a conference table and write your songs. But they really don't. It's usually two or three people. And one of the questions that comes up from that, Tony had it. I said, Danny, let me ask you a question. In this age of this attorney-driven legalism age, does it come down to, well, I wrote the first line and the fourth line of the song, so I get like 6% of the song? The other guy wrote the chorus, he gets 14% of the song? No, Tony, it's not the way it works. We sit down today, three at a table. You're a third, I'm a third, he's a third, we write the song. It doesn't matter if you sat there and all you came up with was a B minor chord. You get full credit, full third credit. So that's the way it is. I don't know what kind of arrangements they may have in Los Angeles or New York or in Belgium, but that's what's pretty much, you know, the way we work in Nashville. And that was kind of cool. The other thing was talking about copyrights, because I know there are questions about that. What happens if I, Tony, have written a song and I take it to our songwriters group and I finish the song. But Janet says, Tony, I think really that last line of the song, instead of talking about a dog, it should be about a cat. And I go, wow, I like that. Change it to cat. Now, does Janet get credit for that? Well, technically, no. Technically, no. And when we talk about this in our songwriters group, I think that gives people that freedom to feel like I can share ideas without, you know, I got to sit down and somehow be beholden to that person later or whatever. It's a lot of freedom in that. So Danny said, the way it works in Nashville, again, among the pros, is if you come in with a song and you've got it put together and somebody gives you an idea about how to change it, usually there's no contest or conversation about compensation. So anyway, that's what I would encourage you to collaborate. Regarding copyright, my advice on that would be, it depends on what your mission or goal is for writing the song. If you're writing it, one of the members of our group, he writes songs for his grandchildren. Now, he was interviewed on NPR last year or year before last about this because it's something just really unique. He writes all these great songs, and he's a great producer, too. I mean, they're like finished radio kind of product. And they're to his five-year-old granddaughter. You know, each year, that's what she gets for her birthday, is a new song from granddad and then the other couple of grandchildren. And they're always unique about that kid, you know. So his goal is to share them with the family. So he probably doesn't copyright those songs. But now, and one of them was played on NPR in that interview. But if your mission is to write a song and try to share it with people that would maybe get in the hands of someone who would then record it and have it in a movie or have it on a TV show, radio, internet, or Sirius or whatever it would be, then it probably is not a bad idea to copyright your song. It's so much simpler now than it was when I first started writing. You know, I used to do the long form, handwrite it, mail it to DC, and wait. The last one, I waited 13 months to get copyright back on. That was right after 9/11. But these days, you go on the internet, you look it up, the Library of Congress, you find what you're looking for, you fill it in, you submit your music and with a fee, and you know it's a pretty short process now. The one thing I would tell you about that process to be wary of so you can save some money is I think the first one that pops up when you look for Library of Congress is somebody wanting to sell you a service. That makes sense? And the service is saying, Tommy, we'll copyright your song through the Library of Congress for you. It'll cost you $115 when you can go copyright yourself for $35 or whatever the fee is right now. So just be wary of that. And I mean, they're a legitimate agency. They're just making money and selling a service, but it's a little tricky, too, for the novice that's going there to copyright, you know. And I would also say that songwriting, in a lot of ways, is like the lottery, but it's not like the lottery. I mean, you know, you kind of go down to everybody. If they got a few dollars extra, they may pop it over here and think, yeah, I'll take a chance. I'll throw $2 down, and maybe I'll win $5,000 or $50,000 or $50 million. It's really not that, because there are some really incredible songs that have never been recorded, and there's some really crummy songs, most people think, that have been recorded, and we hear them, people talking about, would you ever have thought the Achy Breaky Heart would have ever, I mean, think about it. What does it really mean? We were just talking about this some weeks ago in our songwriters meeting about some of the songs that have no meaning, or they're just boring, basically, lyrically, but they got in people's head, they became a groove, they were fun, they made them feel good, and they bought them, and they keep buying them. So the quality of song is not always the case. Now, I heard a lady that we've corresponded with a group in California, she's a Grammy winner, and she said to me one day in an email, she said, Tony, there are a lot of really good songs musically that have made it with bad lyrics. But you don't ever hear a song that has good lyrics and bad music that made it. I'll play you a song then. And then I guess we'll conclude. But this song was his collaboration. And it was written, it's called A Glance, A Whisper, A Kiss. And I started out trying to write something about a shy young man that wanted to catch the eye of this young lady. And he ventured, and there's some cool stuff in here I learned from the group, you know, being a group. Like there's a line in this song where he says, let's see, I'll give it away. He said, the chorus is, all I want is a glance, a whisper, a kiss, a chance that I can't miss. All I want is you by my side, and you could be a friend, a lover for life, you could even be my wife, all I want is you by my side. You know, and one of the ladies in our songwriters group said, well, Tony, that sounds kind of weird. You could even be my wife? Doesn't it sound a little arrogant? So I had to think about it. Does it? Because I mean it that way. But if it's taken that way, I really need to go back and, you know, rethink it. But so I'll talk to my collaborator, and she said, we're not changing that, Tony. But anyway, another point I'd like to make in kind of closing here is, you don't really need to be a good entertainer to write songs. But thank you so much.